want Donald Trump to release his tax returns?
I do not believe that this is a voting issue for a lot of people. I mean, if that's what you're voting on, you're not going to vote for Donald Trump anyway.
No, but does it? I agree with you that nobody will vote yes or no because of that issue. But does it maybe feed into the trust issue, which might be a voting issue?
I mean, maybe the media will try and make it feed in there, but I honestly don't think so. I mean, the whole tax thing. I mean, first of all, I've said for months he should never release his taxes. I went back and looked today. Nixon didn't release his taxes when he was running for president. It was after he was president.
Yeah. No, he did in 72.
You see how that worked?
He did in 68, but he did in 72 when he was under audit.
He was under audit?
He was under audit in 72. Let's do a fact check on that. We're going to take a very quick break. Coming up, who won tonight's debate will reveal the first results from our instant poll of debate watchers. Back right after this. Stay with us.
Overpopulation is the disease. An inferno virus is the cure.
We're looking at an extinction level event.
It's Dante's Inferno.
It's a clue.
Don't trust anyone.
If I can break the code, we can stop this.
The people behind this would do anything to protect the truth.
There are clues in Florence,
Istanbul,
Venice.
The professor has become a liability.
Go, go, let's get him.
There's always a way out.
It's nice to have you back, Professor.
Inferno, we did PG-13.
Back in the good old days, things were just better.
Those old rules don't work for me.
We valued hard work.
I don't believe in anyone telling me how I should live my life.
Skinny caramel macchiato.
Back then, technology was a self-cleaning oven.
I like things the way they were, except my abs.
I do, however, believe in a world with really great abs. Hey, Earl.
Hey, Dave. See my post?
Yeah, it's funny.
In the application economy, there's one thing everyone agrees on.
The Bud Light Party wasn't invited to the debates.
But we don't eat them. We have debates of our own every night.
A hot dog is a sandwich.
Over Bud Lights, of course.
It's pronounced GIF.
You cannot outrun a zebra.
Here's to good-natured civil debates.
Also, it's GIF.
He's got his hand in his waistband. Yeah, he's a black male.
I'm only human. After all, don't put the blame on me.
We now have more African Americans under criminal supervision than all the slaves back in the 1850s.
The 13th Amendment to the Constitution makes it unconstitutional to be held as a slave.
Except for criminals.
The loophole was immediately exploited.
The policies put forward were a use of political force.
Federal crime bill.
Mandatory minimums.
Three strikes.
It became virtually impossible for a politician to run and appear soft on crime.
It was an enormous burden on the black community that violated core fairness.
Called the end of slavery jubilee. We thought we were done then. We get the bills passed to vote, and then they break out the handcuffs.
I'm only human. After all, don't put the blame on me.
This vice presidential debate. I want to go to David Chalian. And David, we got the results from our exclusive CNN ORC instant poll. People who were actually watching this debate, share the numbers with us.
That's right, Wolf. Remember, this is a poll among debate watchers. This isn't a national poll among all voters. And among debate watchers tonight, it was a slightly Democratic advantage in the audience, slightly more Democrats than Republicans were watching tonight. And take a look at who they think won. Mike Pence, 48% say he won the debate, to Tim Kaine at 42%. And as you know, Wolf, this is a game of expectations. So look at this. Did Tim Kaine do better or worse than you expected? 43% say he did worse. 38% say he did better. How about Mike Pence? What did he do in terms of the battle of expectations? 67% of debate watchers said he did better than they expected tonight. 14% said worse. Remember, we're showing Pence won, Pence beat the expectations game, and the audience of debate watchers was actually skewed a little more Democratic. So certainly put the W in the Trump-Pence column tonight.
Good news for Donald Trump. He likes these poll numbers, I am sure. David, stand by. Dana, your reaction to these numbers.
That this is great news for Mike Pence, but the open question is, what does it mean for the guy who really matters at the top of the ticket, and that's Donald Trump? Whether or not the fact that people seem to have liked Mike Pence, and more importantly, as David pointed out, that he exceeded viewers' expectations. Is it going to translate at all to Donald Trump? That's an open question. Historically, the answer is no.
What do you think?
Well, it's an interesting conversation going on in the conservative media. A lot of them not fans of Donald Trump, saying that a win for Pence, which they think this was, is not necessarily a win for Trump in the sense that it shows how Pence was a better debater than the man atop the ticket. And they're also, this is conservative saying, you know, you may think Tim Kaine was annoying to keep repeating and quoting all those things Donald Trump said, but whatever number of people were watching kept hearing Tim Kaine repeating all of those things that Donald Trump has said. I want to give you one insight from somebody inside Trump world who is in the inner circle in Trump world, who said that he does not think this is going to go down terribly well with Donald Trump, even though the Trump campaign is rushing out statements with all conservatives across the country praising Mike Pence. They say Donald Trump is watching the reviews and he's hearing Mike Pence won, but he didn't defend Donald Trump, and that Hillary Clinton and Mike Pence are better debaters than Donald Trump. Some people think that might not sit well with the boss.
Because he did have a lot of opportunities to go ahead and defend Donald Trump, and on several points, he was pretty silent.
Absolutely, which is why one of our first questions to Eric Trump, who was sitting here, was, how did you feel about the fact that Mike Pence didn't take the bait, but he certainly didn't defend your father? You know, as the debate started to go on, I started to communicate with people in Trump world saying, how long until the people who prepared Mike Pence, which was a lot of prep work, are going to be flown to Trump Tower to try to convince the guy at the top of the ticket that this is how you prepare for a debate. You do it with you know, actual mock debates, with somebody playing the opponent, playing the moderator, which is what Mike Pence did very aggressively. But the open question is, even if that happened, would it matter? Because Donald Trump is a very, very different person than Mike Pence.
Two other very quick points. So number one, Donald Trump said he was going to be live tweeting. There was a lot of anxiety in Republican circles when Donald Trump said he was going to live tweet during the debate. Essentially, this was the staff, the communications staff, where they were tweeting press releases, instant reactions to things, and a few comments from Donald Trump about how he thought Mike Pence was doing a good job. But if you look at the tweets tonight versus the tweets over the past, say, 10 years of Donald Trump's life, pretty straightforward and mainstream tonight. Another point to the conversation everyone was having about, look, Mike Pence's tone is very different when it comes to Vladimir Putin and Russia than Donald Trump. But I just was reminded, as Jeffrey and the other panel with Jake were talking about this, remember, at the Republican convention, the Trump forces pulled from the platform tough language on Russia. The traditional hawks in the Republican Party wanted tough language against Vladimir Putin and Russia, and it was the Trump campaign and its influence that pulled that language. So now you hear Mike Pence saying he's a bully, we have to stand up tough to him. Well, that was not Trump's tone at his own convention, and it's not his tone when he talks about this on the trip.
We're getting some reality checks coming in to CNN. Jim Sciutto has been watching this. Jim, what do you have?
Well, the topic, and we've talked about it a lot tonight, Russia. What exactly have Trump and Pence said about their support for him and their leaders? Let's have a listen to Tim Kaine tonight.
The newly emboldened the aggression of Russia, whether it was in Ukraine or now their heavy-handed approach.
You both
their heavy-handed approach.
You both have said Vladimir Putin is a veteran.
We're going to get to Russia in just a moment, but I do want to get back to the question.
But in the midst, Elaine, thank you. Thank you, Senator.
These guys have praised Vladimir Putin as a great leader. How can they defend that?
You heard that there, the claim, Senator Kaine attacking both Trump and his running mate Pence for their praise of Vladimir Putin. So let's look at what Trump and Pence have said. Let's start with the Republican nominee. At the Commander-in-Chief Forum just last month, Trump said that Putin has, quote, very strong control over his country. He went on. Let's have a listen.
He is really very much of a leader. I mean, you can say, oh, isn't that a terrible thing he called him. I mean, the man has very strong control over a country.
Now, Pence denied tonight that he praised Vladimir Putin, but fact is he's made similar comments and more than once about Putin's leadership in Russia when backing up his running mate's comments. Have a listen to Mike Pence.
I think it's inarguable that Vladimir Putin has been a stronger leader in his country than Barack Obama has been in this country.
So the verdict here, and this is a pretty straightforward one, because remember the claim from Senator Kaine was simply that Pence and Trump had praised Vladimir Putin. We heard it, and it was more than those times you heard tonight. We rate this one as true.
Jim Sciutto, thank you. Tom Foreman, you've been doing a reality check as well. What are you learning?